I'm really excited to introduce today our first speaker, who is Mr. Lynn Braband. You wouldn't know it, but Lynn is actually a retired senior extension associate with our program, the New York State IPM program. And I had the pleasure of working with Lynn for 8 of his 21 years at Cornell, where he conducted research and provided education about pests in and around structures, especially nuisance wildlife. And so we're happy to have Lynn today. He'll be talking to us about dealing with raccoon and squirrel problems in buildings. So Lynn, you can take it away.
Thank you, Matt. So for most of our nation's history, really way back into colonial days, our culture tended to classify wild animals as either bad animals or good animals, depending upon how they viewed to interact with our economic interests. So bad animals, such as many predators, were greatly reduced and eliminated over much of their range on the continent. And even the so-called good animals, you know, which we valued for food or other means, we overexploited. There were very little, if any, regulations in that day. And such as the extinction of the passenger pigeon, which 150 or 200 years ago, you could go to your local Wegmans if you wanted and buy passenger pigeon meat. And it was believed that this bird was probably 200 years ago, the most abundant species of bird in the world. Now it's extinct. So about 100 years ago, many wildlife species were at very low levels. They were scarce, even headed toward extinction. And there was, I developed quite a bit of a concern with in our society about this. This is a famous caricature by a Pulitzer Prize winning Ding Darling in the 1930s. He put this in, he was syndicated in many newspapers, and it shows a multitude of citizens group besieging the US Capitol, demanding that things be done to conserve our wildlife and other natural resources at times when they were at very low levels. Many of these species now have recovered, and from a point where, again, they were very scarce or even headed toward extinction. And quite a few of them have recovered in their population so much that they are again in conflict with our economic interests. And so I like this quote from Professor Emeritus Dan Decker from Cornell University on the goal of modern wildlife management is to maximize the benefits of wildlife to humans while minimizing the costs of wildlife. And today we're going to focus on an aspect of minimizing those costs. In particular, we'll be looking at or focusing on problems with squirrels and raccoons in buildings, and they can cause quite a bit of property damage in buildings. And all this information plus much more is in this publication, which can be found online on the New York State IPM website. So first, there are several points that should be considered concerning a wildlife problem, a nuisance animal problem, especially if you're considering removing the animal. The first isn't necessary to remove. So for example, here we have a raccoon and its friend who are helping themselves to a garbage can. Is it necessary to have these animals removed to solve the problem? Probably not. What's needed is better management of the garbage. Know the law is another point, which is very important to consider. The laws regarding wildlife vary from state to state. This is descriptions of an aspect of the laws here in New York State, where all wildlife species are classified as either legally unprotected or legally protected. And this is an unprotected species can legally be taken by the property at any time of the year and by any means, as long as other laws like pesticide regulations, firearm discharge ordinances, trespassing laws, et cetera, are not violated. However, without a permit, the property owner cannot release the animal off his or her property. The animal must be destroyed and buried or cremated. And we'll come back to those permits shortly. In contrast, a legally protected species cannot be destroyed, captured, and/or removed without permits. For some protected species, the landowner may destroy the animal without a permit if the animal is causing property damage. Individuals who have gone through the required protocols to obtain such a permit from the state are known as nuisance wildlife control operators. This is from the website of the New York State Wildlife Management Association, which is the trade group for nuisance wildlife control operators here in New York State. And they have a function, which is a screenshot on, of find a nuisance wildlife control operator in your area. What you do is just click on the county where you live in the state, and you get a list of people who are licensed operators and also belong to these trade associations. The next point to consider are health and safety concerns. Need to be familiar with the safety measures necessary to reduce the risk of contracting zoonotic diseases. This is one example. And also use proper precautions on ladders and with other equipment. Next point to consider, humaneness. Generally, humaneness refers to minimizing the pain felt by an animal. A quick lethal technique is often considered more humane than a non-lethal technique that has a high probability of causing prolonged suffering by the animal. Effectiveness, next point to consider when considering removing an animal or solving a wildlife problem. While other factors are important, if the animal is not removed, the problem, of course, is not solved. Practicality. So the message you're thinking about may be humane, effective, and safe, but it will not be implemented if it's too expensive or otherwise too cumbersome for the owner of the building. And finally, a major point to consider, by no means least, is the social context. Human responses to animals are diverse and often intense. It is important to consider the visibility of the animal removal and choose techniques that will help maintain positive relationships with the building's occupants and the broader community. So with that, let's focus on the main topic for this presentation, is controlling squirrel and raccoons that have gone into buildings. Again, I refer you to the publication Beast Be Gone on the New York State IPM website. Another resource is a fact sheet which you can access through the New York State IPM website, controlling squirrel problems in buildings. Many of those points are also very relevant to raccoon problems in buildings. Okay, inspections. You can hear my dog gnawing on her bone in the background. Inspections. It's always good. Inspections are an important part of preventing or finding problems early on. And for squirrels and raccoons, both, there are two key times of the year where it's important to inspect the exterior of the building looking for problems or potential problems. This is in late February and early March. So we're a little late right now since we're in mid-April, we're almost into mid-April. Because female animals are looking for den sites, and houses and chimneys make very attractive den sites for both raccoons and squirrels. The other time to consider doing a once around of the outside of your building is in late August and early September, when animals start thinking about finding overwintering den sites. Okay, you look for signs of animal presence, like collections of feces, dirty paw prints going up to the sides of gutters, things like that. You're not only looking for current problems, but potential problems, things where there's no evidence that there is an animal entry in, but may be vulnerable to the animals, and decide what to do to make that less vulnerable to animal entry. Both raccoons and squirrels, being cavity dwellers, are very frequently will enter chimneys. Now, raccoons, even with a very secure tile liner throughout the whole chimney, can easily, very quickly go up and down a chimney. They just brace themselves against the sides, and they're very, and it's amazing how fast they can move up and ascend and descend the chimneys. Squirrels can go down a chimney that has an intact tile liner, but they are usually not able to get back up. And so often if a squirrel go down such a chimney, they either fall out, come out of the fireplace or from the exterior vent on the outer casing of the furnace, and the inside, they end up in the house. And the picture on the left is what commonly happens, especially the house has been and no one's at home, is that the squirrel ends up in the house, coming down a chimney often, and goes to a window because it sees the outside and starts chewing on the woodwork around the window trying to get out. In terms of removing animals, of course, there's trapping, including cage traps, which capture the animal alive, such as the raccoon on the left. And there also are cage traps that would allow multiple captures, such as this case with flying squirrels that have entered a house, because often flying squirrels, especially in the winter, there are quite a few, maybe quite a few of them. And there are also lethal traps if you know what you are doing, such as this body gripping trap on the bottom photo over a squirrel entry hole. There also are another approach to removing an animal from inside the building are one-way doors. And these function by allowing the animal to leave but not get back into the structure. They are only effective if the animal can find and use the exit, cannot force their way back in through the door, or find another or even make another entry point. Now, the long-term solution to animal problems on buildings is exclusion. And when thinking about exclusion, closing up entry holes, there are several things to keep in mind. First, is it in or out? A common technique for determining whether an entry hole is active is what's known as a soft plug. And this is something like, in this case, cardboard temporarily secured over the hole, or maybe newspaper or something like that stuffed into the hole, which will not trap the animal inside, but the animal has to either chew, or as has happened here, or push out the plug in order to leave or enter. And so it just tells you whether the hole is active or not. So typically at least during the warm season, if the hole has not been disturbed for 2 or 3 days, that's usually a good indication that at least that particular hole is not active. Time of the year is particularly important in winter. Squirrels are active throughout the winter. Raccoons, although they really do not hibernate in cold snaps, they will take long naps. And so if you have known that you've had raccoons that have been in the chimney or in the attic, and it's wintertime, everything seems to be quiet, the hole seems to be inactive, but it's been a cold snap and the animal is just being inactive, and you close the hole, and the animal is inside, you will have a rude awakening. During this time of year, you need to watch for little ones. One of the indications of this is, of course, is the squealing, squeaky noises that the young animals can make. And if you're close enough to see the female and the teats of the female, it'll be obvious if she's nursing or not. Keep the exclusion legal. Building codes and fire codes need to be met. For example, homemade covers on chimneys usually do not meet fire codes. It's best to go with a commercial screen or cover. Commercial chimney screens, which is on the left, are good for keeping squirrels out from going down the flue. However, raccoons easily remove those. Better for both squirrels and raccoons are chimney covers, which either bolt to the side of the top of the flue, or the larger ones are secured around the entire crown of the chimney. And these meet fire codes. Does it work? Both squirrels and raccoons, they can very readily tear off wood and other materials. And so you often have to think that in order to be effective, in many times it's a think sheet metal over a entry hole once it's inactive. And of course, the last point to think about when doing exclusion is how does it look? You want it to be, since it's on the exterior of the building, especially a house, to be relatively attractive. So this is an entry hole, which was being used by squirrels. And once the squirrels were removed, sheet metal, which matched the color of the side of the house, was used and was fitted to nicely fitted around the hole. And that's all my slides.
Wonderful. Thank you, Lynn. We have a few minutes for questions. So if anybody would like to put a question in the chat, we can ask Lynn. We do have two questions that came in. So we'll try and ask one now. And then if you have time, Lynn, and you want to respond in the chat, that would be great. So the question was, is there any type of essential oil or something that is a deterrent? And you know, I will reference back to a previous presentation that is in this series in the YouTube playlist that describes the use of home remedies for pests and how many of them are not labeled for such uses. But are you aware, Lynn, of any wildlife control repellents or deterrents that are essential oil based?
Yeah, my wife just asked me that yesterday about keeping cats out of her flower beds, but nothing that research has backed up. There was a product, I'm not certain whether it's still on the market or not. Its legality was always, it was the trade name was raccoon eviction fluid. I think it was probably scent glands from male raccoons, you know, that would, you know, would, because boar raccoons will kill young raccoons. And so that's why I'm quite certain that it was probably that,
right.
But was never registered, you know, so in New York State, its use was extremely iffy. And, but in terms of a registered product that has research backing, no.
Yeah, I think the recommendation for exclusion and as you pointed out, sanitation, removing those conditions that are attractive to pests around the structure.
And inspection at key times.
Right, right.
Excellent. So the techniques which in the Beast Be Gone we talk about is to keep tree branches, you know, at least 10 feet away from the house for both raccoons and squirrels. Although flying squirrels, if there can be quite a ways away, you know, if there's large mature trees, I had instances of this where, you know, they would climb those trees and glide to the house.
Wow. 10 feet is a far distance, but yeah, with a gliding mammal.
Well, these trees were further than 10 feet, quite a bit.
Okay. Wow. Well, thank you, Lynn. There were a couple other questions in the chat. I will just mention a question that came in about removing a bat, and we have an upcoming, I think it's a IPM Minute that will talk about bat exclusion. So stay tuned for that. At this time, I would like to introduce our IPM Minute speaker for today, and that is Maria Cramer. And Maria is a PhD candidate in the Department of Entomology at the University of Maryland. She previously worked on IPM for Japanese beetles and spotted-winged Drosophila and is currently studying the impacts of preventative pesticide applications on insect communities in agricultural settings. And today, Maria is going to talk to us about slug and snail IPM. So thank you, Maria. The floor is yours.
Hi, thank you so much for having me. Thanks for that introduction. Yes, and some of the insect communities that I study are the insects that are natural predators of slugs in agricultural systems. And so I work quite a bit on slug IPM in corn and soybeans, and I'm excited to talk to you today about slug and snail IPM in gardens. So the first, first off, why do we care about slugs and snails? They do, we care about them because they eat the things we want to eat, either directly feeding on fruits that we want to eat, especially things like strawberries that are low to the ground. But they can also eat our plants and damage them and keep them from producing later. So they really enjoy eating seedlings when they're just starting to get going. And climate change is making slug and snail problems worse. And that's because slugs and snails, they're soft-bodied mollusks, and they do very well in wet conditions. Climate change is causing wetter springs and summers in the Northeast United States. And so that's just making conditions better for them to be active. Additionally, they overwinter as eggs or as small slugs or small snails, and warmer winters increases their overwintering success and means that when spring comes, we just have more slugs and snails around. So we know that they're a problem. We know that they're sort of getting worse. So what can you do about them? You can manage them with an integrated pest management approach. And this involves identifying the problem properly, determining the severity, basically, do you need to do an intervention? And then finally, using effective low-risk interventions. Let's start with identifying the problem. So the thing about mollusks, as I said, they're soft-bodied. They like wet conditions. That's because they dry out very easily. That means that they're most active at night when it's cooler and generally wetter than during the day. Because of this, you can either go out with a flashlight to find the slugs or snails, or you may have an easier time just finding the damage during the daytime than the pests themselves. The type of damage they cause is fairly distinctive because of the type of mouth parts they have. So a lot of insect pests have chewing mouth parts. They like take bites out of leaves, but slugs and snails have this mouth part called a radula. It's a lot like the rough tongue of a cat. It just sort of scrapes away at plants, picking up little bits of leaf tissue, which they then eat. Because of that, the damage they cause tends to be pretty ragged. So if you look at this corn leaf, you can see streaky damage. They're basically feeding in between the leaves or in between the veins on the leaf there. So you get very streaky damage. This pak choi has sort of irregular leaves with a little bit of raggedness around the edges. And then the really key distinguishing feature where if you see it, you're like, yes, I know I have slugs, are the slime trails. So you can see that on the strawberry there, where slugs and snails leave behind slime as they travel. And sometimes you'll see those slime trails left behind after feeding. So they look like silvery, almost webbing on leaves or on fruits. So if you know that you do have slugs and snails versus like an insect pest or something like that, then you want to determine the severity. Basically, do you need to do something? And that's going to depend on a couple of different things. So if the damage is happening to small plants or large plants, you want to assess, is this actually killing the plant, or is it just more aesthetic? So like this kale here, pretty defoliated, you might want to do something. If the damage is to a fruit that you want to eat, then you have to ask yourself, am I okay sharing, or do I want to be the only one eating that fruit? And if the answer is, yeah, the damage is really serious, I need to do something. And what's going to help inform that decision as to whether you need to do something is also the weather. So slugs and snails dehydrate very easily. So that means that if the weather is hot and dry when you're seeing the damage, it's likely your plants are going to grow really fast and they're going to outgrow the amount of damage the slugs can do to them. However, if the weather is really cool and wet, the slugs and snails are going to stay active and an intervention is more likely to be needed. So if it's like in the fall or really early spring, the amount of damage you see may be worse because they're going to keep, the slugs and snails are going to stay active and they might keep damaging plants. So if you've determined that you need to take an intervention, you want to start with effective low-risk interventions. And you want to start by making your garden less hospitable to slugs and snails. So this means removing heavy mulch, bricks, boards, things like that from your garden. Those all provide really nice shelters that slugs and snails can hang out under during hot weather during the day and then emerge from when night falls to come and eat your plants. Also watering in the morning rather than in the evening will keep you from having, you know, very wet plant like leaves and things like that and soil that may attract slugs and snails. can also foster beneficials. So there are a lot of vertebrates that eat mollusks, including birds, snakes, toads, turtles. All of these vertebrates eat different kinds of mollusks. And then there are also a bunch of mollusk specialist insects, like this ground beetle pictured here, which is feeding on slug or snail eggs. Other insects besides ground beetles include things like firefly larvae. There are also other arthropods, things like spiders, as well as centipedes, all feed on slug and snails and their eggs. So to foster these, you can avoid insecticides in your garden to help build up your population of beneficial arthropods. And then finally, if you've done all these sort of preventative strategies and you still are having really bad slug or snail damage, you can use a chemical intervention, but you want to make sure you're using it and having it be as effective as possible. So slug baits, they're formulated as pellets. So you spread pellets and the slugs or snails feed on them and then are poisoned. The way to make them super effective is to apply late in the afternoon. So right before slugs and snails are going to become active and be feeding. And they have very water-soluble active ingredients. So you don't want to apply them, say, right before a heavy rain when all of that's going to be washed out. So if you're going to use a chemical intervention, make sure you're using it in a way where it's as effective as possible. So in summary, to manage slugs and snails with an IPM approach, you want to make sure slugs are the culprit. You want to make sure they are really causing damage that you can't tolerate. And then you want to start by making your garden less mollusk friendly, and then go on and use chemicals if they are still bad. And obviously with any kind of chemical use, you're going to need to follow the local laws and regulations that pertain to those chemicals. So if you have any questions, please feel free to email me. And for further reading, University of Minnesota has a great extension website on slugs and snails in the garden. And University of Maryland has a fact sheet, which includes managing slugs in the garden, as well as in various commercial applications. So thank you so much for having me. Delighted to take any questions that you have.
Thank you, Maria. Great summary of resources and great presentation. I often hear a lot of questions about snails and slugs and don't know great solutions. And I think you provided some terrific information today. We are at our time for today, but there were a few questions that came in. So hopefully we can have you send us some answers. One that I hear a lot came in, what about the beer baits? So I think it'll be great to have your response to that for our YouTube video description. So thank you everybody for tuning in today. We hope you have a great weekend and we hope to see you at a future First Friday event.